breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings the chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Oh, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun and all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. Hallelujah. Oh, you're so worthy, Lord. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Oh, and worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Oh, worthy is the King who conquered. He is worthy. Oh, he is worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you'd lay down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful tonight that I serve a God that took all the handwriting of ordinances that was against me, nailing them to a cross. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I can stand here tonight. You can stand here tonight with liberty. You can stand here tonight with freedom. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We can hear it growing louder. Songs from every nation rising to your throne. Saints in every generation singing for your glory, telling what you've done. Oh, from the north and south, we are crying out, there is hope in Jesus' name. Oh, and you're amazing, God. You're amazing, God. You can bear the weight of every heavy heart. And you can heal the pain. You can clean the stain. You can turn our tears into songs of praise. You're amazing. From the ashes, sorrow turns to gladness when our God is near. You speak light,
into our darkness.
You heal the brokenhearted, and you wipe away our tears. From the north,
and south,
we are crying. And there is hope in Jesus' name. You're amazing, God. You're amazing, God. You can bear the weight of every heavy heart. And you can heal the pain. You can clean the stain. You can turn our tears into songs of praise around us, songs of praise around us. Hear it growing, we are growing louder. Songs of praise surround us. Oh, hear it growing, we are growing louder. Songs of praise surround us. Songs of praise. Hear it growing louder. We are growing louder. In your amazing God, your amazing God, you can bear the weight of every heavy heart. And you can turn our tears Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's lift our hands all across this room and love an amazing God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He brings light to every situation. Hallelujah, the only God that I know that can truly heal the brokenhearted. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We've got some prayer requests this evening. Sister Jenny Morell is in need of healing tonight. Sister Wendy Hartzeller is in need of salvation and healing. Had surgery on Monday. Needs our prayers. Brother Kelvin, Sister Misty, Sister Tina Coffey are all in need of healing tonight. Tim Watson's in need of healing and salvation. The Barry Horning and family is in need of healing and salvation tonight. Sister Dawn Kasner is very sick, in need of healing. Sister Barbara McCoy is very sick, in need of healing tonight. Brother Parker is in need of healing tonight. Let's remember Sister Nancy Fry. Let's remember Sister Clark. Those that are on our prayer list continually. Let's lift our hands all across this room in faith, believing, knowing that God is going to heal. God, I believe you are the healer. God, we speak it over each and every one of these requests tonight, God, that your virtue would flow out of this place. God, that your virtue would be dispatched and healed. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Do you believe the Lord's a healer tonight? Hallelujah. Can you give him a hand clap of praise and thank him? Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're asking our ushers to come tonight and wait upon us. Receive the evening offering. Give as given unto the Lord. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Worship with us as we sing. Oh, Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, Lord, you are good. Your mercy endureth forever and ever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you, singing hallelujah,
hallelujah.
We worship you for who you are. Oh, we worship you. Oh, we're singing hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Oh, you are good. Oh, Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, Lord, you are good. Your mercy endureth forever and ever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, and people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. We're singing hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. We worship you, Lord. Singing hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Oh, we worship you. We're singing hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Oh, you are good. You are good all the From generation to generation, we worship you. We're singing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. We worship you. We're singing hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I know one thing. There's an old saying that says, he ain't never done me nothing. Brother Huffstall used to sing a song, and it's not proper English, but he ain't never done me nothing but good. I can't think of one thing that God has ever done that hasn't been good. Has he ever changed your life? You're sitting in an apostolic Pentecostal church on a Wednesday night. Has he ever healed your body? Hallelujah. You are good, Lord, all the time. You are good all the time. And all the time, Lord, you are. Hey, you are good all the time. And all the time,
you are good.
Yeah,
the
bush.
All the time. All the time.
All the time, you are. Hey, you are good all the time. All the time, you are, hey, you are good.
All the time,
and all the time, Lord,
you are good.
Yes, you are good. All the time, and all the time, Lord, you are. Yes, you are good. All the time, and all the time, Lord, you are so good. You are good. All the time, and all the time, you are good. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship. We're singing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. We're singing hallelujah.
Oh,
we worship you. For who you are, for who you are, hey, for who you are, oh, you are good. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Let's give him a high praise tonight. Hallelujah. Lord, you're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy of our praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to change the order of service before we do. We're going to dismiss the kids to go downstairs, 4 through 11 years of age. We're going to turn this service to our pastor. Love our pastor. Hallelujah. Thankful for a man of God. Hallelujah. Will you greet him to this pulpit tonight with an apostolic amen?
Hallelujah. Amen. Tonight, as you go praying for my mother's brother, amen, he is not doing very good. Fell a while ago, hit his head, and he's had pressure on his brain. He's 87 years of age, and they're going in to do a sort of procedure to drill into the skull and relieve the pressure from the bleeding of the brain, and he's just not doing very good at all. And my mama went down there. She left the day, actually this evening, and her and Bishop are on their way down. So we pray traveling mercies on them, but also that her brother be okay. He's 87. It bothers my mother when her brothers are on the brink of passing away and they're not right with the Lord, as it should anybody. and she's very distraught. And just pray that God would have his way in this situation. And sometimes blessings are disguised. Me and Sister York was talking about that Sunday. You know, sometimes we don't realize it, but God sometimes has his hand in even some of our trials. And so we're just going to trust that he has his hand in this. Amen. Mark chapter 8, verse 18. Amen. I want to thank you all for being here tonight. And I want to greet all of our visitors in Jesus' name. Let's give our visitors a round of applause tonight. We're so glad you're with us. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Missing some people that's been coming. And let's pray for them. If you know their number personally, your pastor lost his cell phone a week ago. Amen. And, well, I didn't lose it. Somebody lost it. And I asked that somebody where it was. And he said, it's in the tree. And I went over and looked in the tree, and it's not there. Praise God. So I don't know where it's at, but we're going to find it. And, until I find it, I'm going to ask some of you to help me. Some of these people that have been coming, that you might have their number or you might have the ability to contact them. I'd appreciate it if you would help me out and call them. Missing some people that's been coming on a regular basis. The lady we Brother Shane baptized, I'm missing her tonight. Missing Jeremy tonight. And not more of you, Jeremy. The other Jeremy. Amen. Hallelujah. It's good when you got a bunch of names the same in the church. Amen. Mark 8 and 18. Having eyes, this is Jesus, see ye not. Amen. Having ears, hear ye not. And do ye not remember. Amen. Having eyes, see ye not. Having ears, hear ye not. And do ye not remember. Amen. I want to preach tonight, talk to you tonight on spiritual blindness. And we're just going to let God have his way. Praying today, asking him what he wanted to say tonight. And I feel like this is the direction that he wants us to go. Jesus, we love you and we ask you to have your way in this place. I don't want to speak, God. I want you to speak. I don't want to just be me up here. I want you to speak through me. Touch this people tonight and let us hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Midweek Bible study is one of my favorite times of the week because, amen, we could be anywhere. This is not a ritual. And we come because we're hungry for the word of the Lord. Seven of us come because we're hungry for the word of the Lord. And the other 135, I don't know what they come for. Hallelujah. But Simon Peter, amen, is speaking tonight, and I want to draw your attention to what he has to say in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. And I want you just to follow with me. This is a bunch of scriptures here put together that I love to read, and I would ask for you to follow with me as much as you possibly can. Amen, 2 Peter 1 and 1. He says, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them who have obtained like precious faith. And then he goes on that says, with us, through the righteousness of God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. I love that scripture. I love it. That by these you might be partakers of the divine nature. Powerful right there. Being like Christ, to be Christians. Amen. Having partakers of the divine nature and then having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And then he goes on and he begins to break down some powerful points. And beside this, give all diligence. Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience. I love this scripture because when my wife says patience is a virtue, I say, no, it's not. I can prove it. Peter said no. Right? You can't add to your patience, amen, or you can't add to virtue patience if patience is already a virtue, right? That's not possible. So, hallelujah, I love that. When I'm out honking the horn, she says, patience is a virtue. I said, no, baby, patience is not a virtue. Oh, more. There needs to be more men backing me than that. Hallelujah. And the knowledge, temperance, temperance, patience, patience, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, to brotherly kindness, love or charity. And then he says, for if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall be neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind. If you do not have these things and you do not have this ability, you're blind and you cannot see afar off. And you've forgotten that you've been purged from your old sins. Amen. There are some issues with people who are blind. And I know this is a sensitive subject tonight because this is a subject that is an abnormality. There's some issues with people that are blind. In the Old Testament, if you were blind, you could not be a priest. You could not approach the holiness of God because there was a deformity, what the Israelites would consider a deformity in you. And so if you're blind, you could not approach the holiness of God. When you're blind, amen, there's some separation in the Old Testament. Now there is not separation like that in the New Testament, thank God. Thank God we can have deaf sections in our church and we can have blind people come to our church and we can have people that have one arm shorter than the other come to our church. In fact, we love when they come to our church because it's the perfect opportunity for the miracles of God to be performed in our midst. Hallelujah. Amen. But when you're blind, things begin to happen. Things begin to change. Amen. Jesus looked at the Pharisees one day and he said, you hypocrites, ye blind guides, Matthew 23:24, which strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. You see, when you become blind, all you see is yourself. We're going to go deeper in that in a little bit. But all you see is yourself. And when you become blinded spiritually, everything around you becomes a big deal. And really, the only big deal is you. You're the big deal. You got to get down to where the rubber meets the road and pray through again. Hallelujah. There's something about it. When you're blind, you don't see that everything is joy unspeakable and full of glory. You don't see the church as being a post where you can get strength and power and understanding. Ain't that right? Amen. Young men, when you're blind, all you see is who's wronged you and who's messed you over and who's messed you up and what so-and-so is wearing and what so-and-so is doing. And you don't see yourself for who you are. That's all right. I'll preach without you. The reality is that when you're blind, all you have in your mind is what's going on in your life. There's times, amen, that our vision is under an attack because if the devil can keep us blinded, then all we ever see is what's wrong with the church and never what's right with the church. I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to preach for just about 2 minutes on what's right with the church. In spite of what you think, we have a great youth group that is on fire for Jesus Christ. It isn't everywhere, baby, that you see young people being the people who start praise and worship. And it's not everywhere you see young people so on fire. I've been to churches and preached my guts out, and you can't get the youth group off the back row. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you, there's something right with the church when you got youth leading in worship and in praise, and they're not afraid to run the aisles and they're not afraid to dance before the Lord. I'm going to tell you what's right with the church when you got people so hungry for the supernatural, they're willing to come to Bible study on Wednesday night and hear more about what Jesus has to say. I'm going to tell you what's right with the church. In spite of what the devil says, we are still in the finest hour of revival that we've ever been in our life. Hallelujah. In the month of February, I just heard this statistic. In the month of February, in just one little moment in Thailand, amen, 3,000 people received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in a heavenly tongue as the Spirit gave the utterance. A week, not even a week later, 6 days later, in the Philippines, amen, there was a conference going on. And in that conference, 35,000 people were in attendance. And that night, when the word of faith was given, 5,000 people received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in a heavenly tongue as the Spirit gives the utterance. Hallelujah. We are the only
We are the only religion that's allowed to have services inside of the United Nations right now. God has given favor to Art Wilson, and he's having church services, and diplomats and assistants and secretaries are receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I wish I had a church right now that would preach with me. There's some stuff that is right with the church of the living God. Everything's not wrong. But when you're blinded to the things of God, when you're spiritually blind, I'm not talking about physically blind, when you're spiritually blinded to the things of God, all you see is what is wrong with the people of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. You look across the aisle and all you can see is what that so-and-so is wearing. And Jesus said, you blind guides. Now, there's nothing scarier than a blind guide. He's saying, if you spiritual leaders don't know where you're going, the blind will lead the blind and they will all fall in the ditch. So the reality is if you spiritual leaders, you people who are supposed to have it all together, don't know where you're going. He said, there's got to be something wrong. And then he follows up, you blind guides, with this, with strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. You can't see the fact that the reason you see a speck in your brother's eye is because you're seeing the end of the plank in your own eye. What's blinding you is the fact that you don't have a clue about what's going on spiritually. All you can see is the physical and not the spirit. Hallelujah. My son, when he was young, Schaefer, he wouldn't say nothing. Nothing. And we started getting nervous. He had texture problems, still kind of does, but he had texture problems, bad texture problems, and he had other problems. And so this person from our doctor subscribed him to some therapy. And so we had four different types of therapy come into our house. And they did a thing and said, we can do it for free through this government program, blah, blah, blah. And so they came out to our house, and they worked with this boy, and they worked with this boy, and worked with this boy, and he wouldn't say nothing. And say nothing. Hallelujah. This is what I kept saying. Mama always worries, you know. That's a job for a mom. She's supposed to worry. I kept saying, leave the boy alone. He will talk when he's good and ready. Hallelujah. It's not like he can't say something. I've heard him scream. I've heard him yell in the middle of the night. I know he's got to settle down. Just let him go. He'll talk when he's good and ready. Now, I know everybody's kids are brilliant, but man, my children, amen, hallelujah. I like to think that they're okay. But Stephanie and Brittany are nothing compared to Schaefer. When he started talking, he already knew how to count all the way to 100. I'm not exaggerating. You can ask some of these people who know him. When he started talking, he already knew all of his ABCs, all the way to Z. And I'm not just talking about knows how to say it, because everybody knows the song. He knew how to identify it. The other day, we were riding in the car, and I said, what is 1 plus 1? He said, 2. I said, what is 2 plus 1? He said, 3. I said, what is 3 plus 1? He said, 4. And Brittany said, he's only saying that because he can see it on my paper. I said, then what is 2 plus 3, Schaefer? He said, 5. I said, what is 3 plus 4, Schaefer? He said, 7. Yeah. The kid's brilliant. Little Einstein. Hallelujah. Thank God. Amen. He's going to make me millions. Praise the Lord. I'm glad for that. Amen. He's brilliant. But the reality is that we were all concerned, and it all was to do with his maturity level. We were so concerned he wasn't learning, and when he started speaking too much. Matter of fact, the other day, he has this thing, and if you don't like it, God bless you. The prayer room's on the downstairs and on the right in my office. But he has this thing he likes to do with his hair. He calls it a stegosaurus do because he spikes it right down the middle of his head. He likes that. He likes to spike it down the middle of his head. And the other day I was doing my best to get it to spike, but he wouldn't stand still. And so when he finally got to stand in the mirror, he looked at me and said, Dad, my spike is leaning a little too far to the right, just like that. I said, I got news for you, dude. We're going to put you back in therapy, teach you not to speak. Hallelujah. Amen. He's maturity caught up. And the reality is that his maturity level, amen, was just not there. When he started speaking, he was speaking profoundly. Matter of fact, amen, I would say that on track wise, he's got a lot of things beat because he's just now, he shouldn't even be in kindergarten, but he's just now starting to do some of that stuff. And he already knows too much. I'd say this. We're looking around at people and we see a little baby over here, and all we can think is they should be running. But they're just a baby. They should be speaking, but they're just a baby. And when they start speaking, they're going to be so far ahead of you, it ain't even going to be funny. Because they're learning in the moment that they're supposed to be learning in. Not every baby's supposed to come out and start eating steak. We're glad you did, but not every baby is. And the reality is that we can become so blinded that we can forget, as Peter said, as we forget how we have been purged from our old sins. And we have become so blinded. And I'm telling you right now in the fear of God that Satan is after the vision of the church. Isaiah was in a moment where he said, the burden of the valley of vision, what aileth thee now? Art thou gone up to the rooftop or the housetop? And he began to say, the vision is under attack. Our spiritual vision is under attack. It was in so much trouble that he said it has been treaded down. It was in so much perplexity that he said, I'm going to go and I'm going to travail and I'm going to weep, and don't try to stop me because I'm worried about what we're seeing. I've already preached about distractions a couple Wednesday nights ago. Now I'm going to talk to you about vision and blindness, spiritual blindness. Because next year we have a vision that's got to be carried out by everything inside of us as a church. I know it's December and I know your mind is on Christmas wreaths and Christmas ornaments, but I've come to tell you our vision is under attack, and God wants to do something in this church tonight that is going to transpire us to a new dimension of glory and greatness. The clouds of diversity is going to begin to clear up, and things are going to be revealed tonight that we've been trying to see for a long time. Things are going to be brought back into focus that we have been trying to see for a long time. God wants to heal us of spiritual blindness that we might have eternal focus for the rest of our days. The Bible says where there is no vision. Help me out, all you Bible scholars. Where there's no vision, the people perish. Not just the sinner, not just the saint, but all people perish when the vision suffers. All the people. We have got to stop looking through blinded eyes. There is a great ability that is getting ready to be brought back to the church. In our church lately, we've noticed a greater problem. Amen. In Luke 6 and 39, he speaks a parable unto them. Can the blind lead the blind? Shall they both not fall into the ditch? The disciple is not above his master, but every one that is perfect shall be as his master. Why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but perceivest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Either thou canst say to thy brother, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine eye, when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye. Thou hypocrite, Jesus said, cast out the first, the beam out of thine own eye, amen, and then thou shalt see clearly to pull out the mote that is in thy brother's eye. People falling out with God because they're being led by the blindness of their own thinking. People getting distraught because they think they know what they do not know. People getting so upset, yet they have so many spiritual problems in their own life that they cannot see what's really going on in the church around them. In spite of what you might think, when you have a problem with young people praising and worshiping God and doing what they've been doing, we've got to get back to the reality that there's too much carnality in our own lives, and we're seeing too much of our own self, and we got a mirror that's in front of us that we might not like to see. Become policemen of our own spiritual doctrine, and we have not become doers of true reality of what God wants us to do. We have invented rights and wrongs. And that's okay. And we've invented rights and wrongs in our own lives called personal convictions. And then we get mad when everybody don't live on the same level we are. That's all right. It's quiet again. And there's a whole lot more about going to hell because of discord than there is about going to hell because you don't dot your I and cross your T just the way you think they should dot their I and cross their T. When I was on the evangelistic field, I only wore white shirts because some preachers believe that if you wear a colored shirt, you're not right. What they forgot was priests wore the color blue when they went into the holy place. The other thing they forgot is white is still a color. And ain't nobody want anybody to wear a clear shirt. Hallelujah. Can I get an amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Yeah, thank you, Brother Chris. I'm going to try. The reality is that I didn't wear a colored shirt because I didn't want to offend my brother. But I have on tonight a little polka dot. It's white, but it's got polka dots in it. I would hope that you wouldn't get so distraught over my polka dot that you would lose out with God. But if you're going to, please come and see me. I'll wear white. I don't want you to go to hell over a polka dot. That's Paul writing right there. That's Paul. Amen. If meat offends my brother, I won't eat meat if that's going to really send you to a devil's hell. But I want to ask you a question. How often do you pray? When's the last time you fasted? Do you ever think about a lost world? Notice how my amens are leaving. Hallelujah. The reality is that we can get so blinded by things that we cannot even prove biblically. And we fight people over things we cannot prove biblically. And yet really in the factual reality of God's kingdom, he is weeping. Because he's looking at us saying, come on, before you worry about whether Jacob's shirt is blue or purple, and before you worry about whether Preston should wear a blue tie with a blue shirt, first, have you made it to the prayer room tonight? Did you ever in your mind, myself, did you ever in your mind realize that when you gossip, it is beyond what God wants you to do? In fact, God said there's a few things that I hate and seven of them are abomination to me. And he said the reality is if you're doing what God hates, that's a whole lot more distracting in a kingdom of God and revival than if you're doing the little things that maybe you should not be doing. I'm not counting those things out. The fact is holiness is still right. And godliness is still right. In fact, I was in the drive-thru, amen, waiting on something today. And as I was waiting, I was sitting there thinking, amen, when they brought the tabernacle, amen, back together and Solomon built the tabernacle and the ark of God came back into the tabernacle. Brother Coffey, they did not have the budding rod of Aaron in the ark and they did not have the pot of manna in the ark. All they had was the law in the ark. And God said, I'm going to still send my glory, because what matters to God is divine order even more than authority and even more than the Holy Ghost being poured out. He wants divine order because he will not work where there's chaos. We've got to have holiness. We've got to have purity. Come on, somebody in this house. We've got to have godliness, but don't get so strung out that you cannot realize that before I can ever minister to the broken, I first got to get to a place of repentance. Hallelujah. I'll quit. Give me 5-10 more minutes. I'll be done. There's no greater story in the Bible to help you understand what I'm preaching about than when Jesus comes to Bethsaida and he looks at a blind man that besought him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes, he put his hands upon him and he asked him if he saw aught. The first thing we can see is the blind man is living in a dimension where nothing else matters more than being healed. All he can think about is, I have got to change. Amen. His blindness is overwhelming him. Amen. He is living in blindness. Paul said it like this in Ephesians 4:17. This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that ye henceforth walk not after as the other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is inside of them because of the blindness of their heart. John the Revelator said, you got to be careful in Laodicean moments and mentalities that you are not, amen, in the middle between cold and hot. Because if you're in the middle between cold and hot, he said, you're going to say you're rich and you're increased with goods and you don't have need of nothing. But you don't know that you're wretched, you're miserable, you're poor, you're blind and you're naked. He said that you are so one-dimensional that all you see is what you think you've got. And because you're living in a one-dimensional mentality where you're blinded to the light of God, you don't even realize how blind that you are. John said there is a sinful darkness that you can walk in that blinds your eyes, that all you can see is yourself. 1 John 2:11. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness and doesn't know whether he's going, because that darkness hath blinded his eyes. I would hate to hate somebody so much that I live in darkness. I would hate to think aught against my brother or my sister so much that I live in darkness. Hallelujah. Somebody came here not too long ago and they started recapping their bitterness towards certain people in our church. They hadn't came here for a while, and they started telling about their bitterness. I'm bitter at so-and-so. I haven't forgiven him about this, and I haven't forgiven him about that. And I went home, and I told my wife. I said, I'm going to tell you, that was so weird to me because I don't deal with that like I used to. I feel like, for the most part, we live in a church that loves each other. Well, that went over like a lead balloon. I said, I feel like for the most part, we live in a church that loves each other, that's willing to look past each other's faults because we realize we're all sinners saved by the grace of God. And it just doesn't make much sense to me when people start vomiting bitterness out. Amen. Because I'm so far removed from that mess that I do not understand it. I don't understand how you can be so bitter at somebody and have so much hatred that you walk in a spiritual darkness all the time. But John said it's possible that you can have so much hate for your brother or your sister that you cannot even see the light of God. You're blinded by hate. Wasn't that a message Brother Adams preached here Sunday night? My Lord, he tried to get down where the rubber meets the road and remove scars. But I was talking to him Monday morning, and he was venting to his pastor, not because, amen, he wasn't telling names. He just was venting. He said, Pastor, nothing hurt me more than the same people that I seen with scars all over them while worship was going on. When I got done preaching, I turned around, I prayed, I turned back around, and they were still sitting in their pews. And he said, I thought to myself, tonight could have been your night to have removal of all that scar tissue that was in your life. I said, man, I know when you preach your guts out and you know who God's talking to, because I know you think that I'm just up here and I'm just dancing my eyes around, but I'm going to tell you, God speaks to me while I'm looking at you, and he tells me things, not sins. He doesn't go down and say they've been doing this all the time, but he shows me things in the spirit. And when you get done preaching a message like this message tonight, and you sit here and you preaching about not hating your brother and not hating your sister, and people are looking at you and amening you, knowing full well that they will never forgive certain people in the church, I'm going to tell you, my friend, you live in spiritual darkness and blindness. I'm getting less and less amens. It's when you are in the position that all you can see is yourself. You don't want more of God because you cannot see past your own sinful desires. You don't want more of God because you can't see past your hate. And Jesus shows up to this man, is living in this dimension of blindness. And the first thing that Jesus does is he takes him by the hand and he leads him out of the city. He changes his surroundings. Matter of fact, I was looking today as I was studying. Every time Jesus healed a blind person, except when they were demonic demonically possessed, and that was the reason they were blind. Every time he healed a true blinded person that was blind because of illness or sickness or disease, every time he got them out of where they were at and led them to another place. And I asked God, why? He said, I had to change their surroundings because the safety of being blind is familiarity. You love for people to leave you alone, let you do your routine. You like to come to church and preachers not preach on your issue. You don't mind they preach on the other issue. Just don't let them preach on your issue, because blindness loves familiarity. Me and Brother Coffee and my wife was in Georgia at one moment, and we went to a place called Dialogue in the Dark. And before we went into Dialogue in the Dark, it was a place where you went through a blind, you were completely, it was pitch black, didn't matter if you had your eyes open or closed. And before we went in, they said this to us. They said, if you want to experience something you've never experienced, please get out some money that you know what the dominant... You know the amount, we'll say that so I don't mess it up. Did you know that it's a $1 bill or a $5 bill? Put it in your pocket and keep it there. And don't put anything else in that pocket, just that one bill. I said, all right. So we went through this whole thing, and we got to this store type deal. And you had to fumble through it and pick out a soda. And the person that was leading us was blind. And you had to fumble through it and pick out a soda. And when you picked out the soda, you took it to the cash register and you felt your way through it. And when you got to the cash register, you reached in your pocket and you said, I'd like to buy this soda. How much is it? And they said, well, it's, I think it was like a dollar something. They said, dollar something. I said, well, I have $2. And I handed her $2. And she rang me out, gave me my change, and I put that in my pocket. The only comfort I had was I already knew that going in. So it was familiar. I already knew what was in my pocket. I already knew everything, because if I wouldn't have known that and I'd had a bunch of bills in my pocket, I would have felt vulnerable. Right. Familiarity is everything. Yeah. We were stumbling through that at one point, and Morgan was a young man. He wasn't married then. We had a lot more I'm sorry's before Kayla came along. And we were stumbling through Dialogue in the Dark, and Morgan was bumping into people. You're supposed to use your stick a little bit more than he was. He wasn't using it very well. He was using it more as a walking cane than a feeling thing. And he stumbled, and I heard him say, oh, I'm sorry, whoever that was. And Sister Ning goes, that's okay, Morgan. He ran right into her, slammed into her. It was a very crazy experience. And one of the most frightening things is trying to go through this thing. We went through this one area, and it wasn't a real street, but they had it sounding like a street. They said, okay, we're going to cross the street, all right? And you got to wait and make sure there's no cars. And all that. And we went up, and I felt the curb, and I'm getting ready to step off the curb, and I put my foot down. As I put my foot down, this car, it sounds like it's really a car. It comes, and she goes, well, you would have just died. I was unfamiliar with what was going on, stumbling through this dialogue in the dark, being led by a blind person that knew how to feel their way through. But when I changed my surroundings, I died. Morgan almost killed my mother-in-law. We got on a boat and about drowned. And if I wouldn't have had that familiarity of what was in my pocket, I would have paid too much for a drink. It's familiarity that we like to hold on to. I'm not trying to bore you by telling you that story. But the fact is that when God comes and he wants to heal us of spiritual blindness, he has to do the same thing he does to the physical blindness. He cannot leave us where we've always been. He cannot let us be the person we've always been. If we've always been sitting here by the side of the road begging, blind Bartimaeus screams out to Jesus, and Jesus says to him, if you really want to come, then come on. And the Bible says he threw off his beggar's garment and he went to where Jesus was. Jesus made him change his surroundings because he said, as long as you're comfortable, you'll never be healed and you'll never receive a miracle. And that's why I come to preach to you tonight that spiritual blindness is much the same thing. As long as you're comfortable and you do what you've always done, you will always get what you've always got. And according to Einstein, that is the definition of insanity. We have got to move past the reality of doing what we've always done and getting what we've always got. And we've got to say, you know what, Jesus? I do not want to walk in darkness. I want to see that great light that Isaiah prophesied about. Amen. The way you know that you're in that spot, you say, well, how do I know that I'm there? The way you know that you're in that spot is you think you know how to lead people, but in reality, all you know how to do is pick at people and what they've done wrong. The problem is people like that are dangerous because they will always lead you to downfalls and ditch moments. And the only way that you can get past that, Jesus said, the only reason I speak in parables is because seeing they do not see and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Jesus said, I could preach a lot shorter of a message if people would just listen to what I'm really saying and see what I'm really saying. You know why it takes a good hour of praise and worship to get somebody to move like they should have moved on the first shout and the first note? It's because we have become spiritually blinded to our own self. And what we're going to have to do is get out of our comfort zone and shake off familiarity and lay aside our beggar's clothes and get to where Jesus is. He took the blind man by the hand, led him out of town, and spit on his eyes. He put his hands on him, and he asked him, what do you see? And he looked up, and he said, I see men as trees, and they're walking around. He does something that I don't understand. He spits on his eyes, probably to get him out of his comfort zone and to get him so beside himself that he was ready for a change. There is nothing. There's three things I hate. You want to get me fighting mad? Put wet hair on me? Put dust bunnies that come from the nostril cavities on me? Or spit on me? I cannot stand wet hair. It's just a pet peeve. I know you brethren love it when you get in the shower and your wife's wiped her hair all over the shower wall, but I don't, man. It's the nastiest thing. Oh, Jesus, have mercy. I got an amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. There is nothing nastier. You want to get my victory? Let wet hair get on me. And then, hallelujah, not very many people have done this, but you let that get on me, man, from the nostril area, and it makes me upset. Man, give me a break. Hallelujah. And then spit on me. What an insult. Honk up something. Spit it in somebody's face. Ugh. Man, you better be ready to duke it out right now. Hallelujah. Don't spit on me. Jesus spits on him. And I think the reality was, because, I mean, hey, we're talking about Jesus Christ. He could have said twang. No, he chose to spit. And I think what he was trying to see is how far is this guy willing to be uncomfortable? Is he ready to go past not only his comfort zone, but get into a place where he might even be a little grossed out, a little uneasy? Hallelujah. You know, we come down, we pray. It's uncomfortable to come to an altar sometimes because everybody's looking at us, and we don't want them to think we have the problem that the preacher's talking about. Especially after he preached about loving your brother and all that. Nobody goes to the altar on those nights. Everybody says, oh, I love my brother. Hallelujah. But when you come to an altar, sometimes we just go through the motions. You know what I'm talking about. Amen. Hallelujah. I don't know what it's been, but for the last, I don't know how many days, I'm just like zonked, man. I've been so tired. I don't know if it's the aftermath of what I went through last week or what, but I've just been zonked. I mean, I could sleep standing up. I'm out of it. And the night before church, hallelujah, I was telling somebody, I said, man, I am so tired. I'm going to get up and say, amen, go home. Let's go to bed. Praise God. I'm tired. You ever been there? And when you come up and pray and you're tired, man, it's so hard. Focus, you know. Jesus, have mercy. I'm just trying to pray and get through the clouds and get through the mind, and you almost feel blinded itself. I've pulled people off of altars asleep before. Hallelujah. I prayed for somebody the other day. I won't say who you were. I was going around praying for people, and I laid my hand on them. They jumped. I thought, well, they were asleep. Praise God. Hallelujah. Pray for them. Amen. God, wake them up. It's all right. Amen. I've been there myself. I've slept in the prayer room. I've slept everywhere and praying. But in that moment, sometimes we're so comfortable that we do. We just kind of zonk out. We come up to pray. We don't remember what the preacher preached for by the time we get done. Hallelujah. Oh, God. God, I felt bad for him. Nobody came to the altar, so I came. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. And so we get done praying. I don't know where that came from. Probably from a repressed emotion. Hallelujah. And when we get done praying, we don't even know what we're praying about. Hallelujah. And God's saying, I'm going to have to spit on them. Because they're so comfortable, they're so familiar with church as usual, and just going through the motions. So he blows our mind, you know. I remember back in the day, there was this lady, she, you know, just when you think it couldn't get any quieter, she'd scream and yell real loud, hallelujah! And Sister Irma, man, she'd give you goodads on doodads, and you think, she could have picked a better time to do that. Hallelujah. I loved it when I got older, but when I was younger, man, woo! Scared me to death. And man, but it shook you. Shook your world. Hallelujah. Wow. Hey, yeah. Amen. Praise God. You remember that story? Amen. Preacher just got tired of Brother Joe. He always went to sleep on Sunday morning. So he started whispering, preaching real low. And he told the church, he said, here in a little bit, I'm going to scream. If you don't love Jesus, stand up. And he said, I'm going to scream it. But I don't want anybody to stand up. And so he did it. And old Brother Joe, all he heard was stand up. That was the last words he heard. He popped up like this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Y'all remember that story? He said, hallelujah. Praise God. And he looked around. He said, well, preacher, I don't know what you're saying, but looks like me and you are the only one who agree. Hallelujah. Me and you are the only ones standing up. All right, I'll quit. I don't know where all that came from. I'll quit doing it. Hallelujah. Amen. We get down here, we need to get uncomfortable. And God has to shake our world. And then God asks him. He says, what do you see? He says, I see men as trees. They're walking around. Now, we've had a lot of people that wants to debate that. Some people say he's seen into a dimension that nobody else could see. He's seen angels, big tree-like men. And I mean, that might make sense. Many say that. But verse 25 said he was restored and saw all men clearly. We get saved, and we get this mindset that as long as I can see, I'll be all right. My dad, that's why I said pray for traveling mercies, because my dad can't see very good. I'm going to close. My dad can't see very good, and when he drives, he makes me very nervous, especially at night. He just scares the fire out of me. And we were in Branson. He said, you see that building over there? He said, there's numbers on it. He said, I can see it, but I have to hold my eye just right, shut my right one, and get a spot in the left eye where it's like not fuzzy. And I said, that's scary, Dad. That's a scary thing. And, you know, it's not fun to not see clear. It's not fun. That's not easy. You know, we gave him card for his birthday, and he can't see it. He has to get his glasses, and then he still has sometimes say, Mama, what does that say? That's not fun. To have that mindset. And when we walk spiritually like that, we can see, but we don't see clearly. I was going to go into a whole deal, and I've wasted too much time on what causes us to get to a blind place. But the fact is when we get to a place where we're blind and we don't see clearly, we cannot get satisfied with that. If we're not seeing the way we're supposed to be seeing, we cannot get satisfied with seeing things okay. Well, I feel Jesus. I just don't feel him like I used to. Well, I used to dance and shout and praise God, and I used to be on fire. I'm coming to church, and I'm saved. I just ain't like I used to. I'm not where I used to be. That's not enough. Jesus said, how do you see? They said, well, I see. I just don't see clear. I see men as trees. He said, that's not enough. We're going to pray again. Jesus Christ prayed twice. That a man might be healed of his blindness. And tonight, I'm telling you that we need such a miracle of spiritual healing where we're not spiritual blind anymore, that we've got to get to a place where we say, God, I'm not getting up from an altar until I can see so clearly in the spirit that I know things that I shouldn't even know. I know when I preach like this, sometimes people don't know how to take me. But I believe God wants to show us things spiritually that would blow our minds. Brother Wardwell told a story. I got to watch what I say, but he told a story. He said there was a man in his church that he said, I'm telling you the truth. It's documented. He said, this man in my church was praying, and he said he was just asking God for a deeper walk. He'd go to church every day. And he said he had this dream. He said, Pastor, I had this dream. We got in this plane with these these Arab men, and these they were flying. They flew over the seas, and they said it flew into the World Trade Center. He said, we flew into the World Trade Center, and it blew up. The World Trade Center came down, Pastor. He said, I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means. 2 days later, the news hits. World Trade Center is coming down. Men from the Middle East is the ones that did it. And he said, that boy was at my house. His name's Mike King. He said, that boy's at my house on my doorstep saying, Pastor, why did God show me that? Why would he show me that in a dream? Now, see, I can see your eyes. Some people are looking at me like, I don't believe you. Some people are looking at me like, come on, preacher. And some people are looking at me like, oh, whatever. He said, why would God show me that in a dream? Why would he show me that? There ain't nothing I could do. If I'd have told somebody that was getting ready to happen, they wouldn't have believed me. Why would he show me that? And Brother Lloyd said, son, only thing I can tell you is God wants to say to you things that's going to happen. He's going to speak to you about things that's going to happen in the future and be so precise. And he's doing this to increase your faith. That's why he showed you that. He didn't show you that because he thought you could make it not happen. You don't need to go, because that boy was, he was distraught. Was I supposed to say something? Am I the reason why people died? How would he show me that? And I've come to tell you, Carmel's not any better than Danville, Indiana. And God wants to show us things in the spirit that we don't even know how to handle right now. And the only way he can do it is he's got to pray over us, spit on us, lead us out of our comfort zone. I'm telling you, there's young people in the sound of my voice. God wants to use you in so many giftings that it would blow your mind. But if he did it right now, you ain't ready for it, because there's some blindness in you. There's some things in you that's not right. And what you've got to do is you got to get out of your comfort zone. And you got to say, you know what? I did not just come to church to just play around. I came to church to worship God. I'm going to tell you, it did my heart good tonight to look over and see these two young men that were on the front row, Jacob and Preston, with their arms raised, stepping up a little bit farther than even the front row desired, and praising and worshiping God, because he wants to use anybody who's hungry enough to leave their comfort zone and get out from where they've been living and say, God, if you can use anything, use me. Show me what you want me to see, God. Don't let me stay in spiritual blindness. Hallelujah. I wish we'd pray and get up and look around. And if we didn't see angel, if we didn't see that, get back down and start praying again. Because when we got up from a prayer room the first time that we got the Holy Ghost, we thought everybody was Holy Ghost filled and saved. We thought everybody was angels. We didn't get up and say, angel, demon, I don't like him. She don't dress right. No, we got up and said, everybody's an angel. I wish we'd pray and get up and say, is everybody an angel? Nope, I'm going to pray again. I'm not seeing men the way I'm supposed to see men. I'm seeing men unclear. I'm seeing men like my enemies. I need to see them like my brothers and sisters. Sister Adams, if you'll come. Peter's talking about, in his last letter to the church, he's talking about promises. He said, we're given exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature of God. The divine nature of God. Jesus walked into a room, the room changed. I believe we should walk into a room and the room should change. That's the divine nature of God. Peter took on the divine nature of God. His shadow began to heal people. I believe that God still wants to do that kind of spiritual, supernatural thing in our midst. But we're so comfortable with being blinded by carnality and by liberalism and by immorality and by the junk that don't even mean. Never forget one year. It was the year that the Colts made the Super Bowl. I walked to this pulpit and I said, folks, I was praying and the Lord spoke to me and said, lay off all media. Facebook, MySpace. Back then we had MySpace. Facebook, MySpace, Twitter, anything, whatever we got, I want you to lay off of it. Get rid of all media. If you got radio you normally listen to, cut it out. Whatever. Brother Scobie went home, canceled his newspaper for a few months. We took it very seriously. The first Wednesday night we came in here, we wasn't fasting food or nothing. We just fasted meat. The first Wednesday night we came in here, a lady got healed, her back instantaneously. She'd had back pain for like 6 months. And Brother Coffee, she raised her hands and boom, she was healed instantaneously. It's not because of anybody. It was because we got rid of all that junk. We seeing men as trees, and then we start seeing men like they're really supposed to be seen. We got out of our comfort zones. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, all right. I'll close. Sister Adams, you want to start playing? He said, not only do I want you to be partakers of the divine nature of God, escape the corruption that's in this world, but beside this, I want you to put yourself on the checklist of how to know if you have perfect vision. How to know if you have perfect vision. Beside this, give all diligence. Add to your faith. You got faith? Check it off. Virtue. You have virtue? Add to your virtue knowledge. You have knowledge of the Lord? You have knowledge. You got knowledge of a lot of stuff. We got some smart people in this room. You have knowledge of godly things? Add to your knowledge temperance. Oh, no. Now we're starting to go deep. And to your temperance, patience. Now we're going real deep, especially for all of us men. Hallelujah. And to patience, godliness. To be more like God, to be holy. To your godliness, brotherly kindness. Anybody got perfect vision still? And to brotherly kindness, love. For if these things be in you and abound, you're going to be fruitful and you're not going to be barren. But he that lacketh these things, and he is blind. If you lack any of these, Phil, if you do real good in all of it, but you have a problem with patience. If you do really good in all of it, but you have a problem with brotherly kindness. You do real good in all of it, but you just have an issue with love. He said, this is the real problem of why you're blind. You have forgotten that you're a sinner saved by grace. You've forgotten that you've been purged from your old sins. So this is what God said tonight in an altar call. He said, I want to enlighten eyes. Enlighten eyes. Ephesians 1:18, this is my closing scripture, if you'll stand. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him up from the dead, set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, above all principality and power and might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And this is what blows my mind. And hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. If we are his body, then Satan is under our feet. Which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. How does it all start? It all starts with the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, for you to realize just who you are. Because the same time 3,000 people were added to the church in February, 5,000 people were added to the church in February. At the same time that was happening, amen, Lee Stone King was going before the United Nations and telling everybody, including Kim Jong-un, you have to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. The other day I seen a preacher get up before the U.S. Senate, not just his state Senate, the U.S. Senate. A Pentecostal preacher grabbed the microphone and prayed over the congregation of the U.S. Senate. Let me tell you, God has given the church divine favor, and the Holy Ghost is being poured out upon all flesh. And this is the greatest day to be apostolic. But we can walk around in a blind fog if we're not careful, because all we see is what's wrong and what's this and what's that. I'm telling you right now, your eyes of our understanding needs to be enlightened. We need to come down to an altar and say, God, get me out of my comfort zone. And I'm not just talking about young people, because young people love to be shook up. They love to have things just mess their world up. They love exciting services where a preacher says, everybody switch seats. But us, we're setting our ways. All of us people that are over the age of 30, we're setting our ways. We like it routine. We like to cut it and dry it. We like our cereal just a certain way. We like our coffee in the morning. And we like to go to bed at a certain time. And some of you are saying, I like to go to bed right now. Amen. There's something about it. We love our routine. I'm asking some elders to lead the march to an altar today and say, God, I want you to get me out of my comfort zone. I'm asking some young marrieds to say, God, get me out of my comfort zone. Get me out if I've got any blindness in me. If I see things certain ways that you don't want them to be seen. God, put my out of Moshea. Put on a Mokatia. Put your hands on me. Lord, whatever you got to do. Lord, I remember Bishop preaching the wit of spit. God, if you've got to spit, if you've got to do it, God, if you've got to shake me up, if you've got to just tell me go wash in the pool of Siloam, if you've got to give me my marching orders, I'll get in divine obedience. Come on, young people. Now it's your turn. Shake me up, God. Change me, God. Some of you young people have gotten so comfortable with your routine. Nothing gets you shook up anymore. Don't get comfortable. God wants to heal you tonight. Spiritual blindness has got to leave. We got to see things the way God wants us to see them tonight. Come on, don't just come down here and already forget what the preacher preached. Let God shake you up. Don't just come down here, close your eyes, and start nodding off because you had a long day. Let the preacher, let what he preached to you get in your heart. Let it get in your spirit today. Sister Adams is singing.
Holy Spirit, break us. God. Come and overtake us. You're the one we're living for. There is nothing we want more. Teach us how to live beyond ourselves.
Let the eyes of my understanding
everything
be enlightened. God, if you can trust anybody from Carmel with a secret like that, God, I want to be able to be trusted with that kind of secret. Speak to me tonight, God. Shake me up, God. Change me. Let me have the divine nature of Christ. Let me go off the spiritual checklist of perfect vision. Let me add to my faith, virtue, and my virtue, patience. My patience, brotherly kindness. My brotherly kindness, love, and temperance. God, let me keep going until I reach all the fruit of the Spirit, Lord. Let me reach spiritual maturity in my life.
The heart of Jesus, there is nothing we want more. We want more.
God, yada la mosha, yada la maranda moto ya
sa. Take me back to my first love. I'm falling on my knees. Now I confess that you will always be enough. Holy Spirit, break us. Come and overtake us. You're the one we're living for. Holy Spirit, lead us to the heart of Jesus. There is nothing we want more. Oh, Holy Spirit, break us. Come and overtake us. You're the one we're living for. Holy Spirit, lead us to the heart of Jesus. There is nothing we want more. We want more. We want more.
It's all about you. It's not about me. And I decrease as you increase. It's all about you. It's not about me. And I decrease as you increase. You're the one we're living for. Holy Spirit, lead us to the heart of Jesus. There is nothing we want more. Holy Spirit, break us. Come and overtake us. You're the one we're living for. And Holy Spirit, lead us to the heart of Jesus. There is nothing we want.
Let's sing together. I decrease, and I decrease as you increase. It's all about.
It's all about.
Oh, it's not about me.
It's not about me.
Say it again. Say, I decrease.
I decrease.
Oh, as you increase. It's all about you. It's not about me. One more time. Say, I decrease. As you increase. It's all about you. It's not about me. God, right now I'm asking you to touch every person in this room. Lord, sometimes even the greatest of us can become blinded spiritually. And we think that we know where we're at and what we're doing, but truth is that we don't realize that we're cold and we're blind, and we're wretched, and we're naked. We're like the Laodicean church, God. We've counted the wrong things as blessings. I'm asking you, God, to help us to see the way you want us to see. Let us see things, God, as blessings, the way you want us to see them as blessings. Lord, sometimes the darkest trials can be the greatest blessing. And I'm asking you to give us the strength to overcome every spiritual obstacle as we start seeing God the way you want us to see. Especially, God, those of us that get set in our ways and we become stubborn. Lord, I'm asking you to help us all. God, take this message home with us. Pray over it. Let it digest into our spirit. God, heal us of our spiritual blindness. Enlighten our eyes as we go from this service tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. We thank you for it. Somebody say amen. Amen. God bless you. Don't forget, this Friday there's no amen church here. I think there is youth service here, and then there is that right? Youth service is here, I think. And then there's prayer. It's going to be here. So please be here if you can. Also, don't forget that, amen, Saturday is couples fellowship shopping night. It's date night for couples, and we're going to be together. And having a good time shopping. Amen. Working on our patience. Ain't that right? Papal coffee. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yes, sir. Yes, all the young people downstairs. Fundraisers coming out. Amen. If you got the ability, amen, to do that quickly. Amen. Going to HYC, then turn around going to NAYC. It's going to be a good week. Or a good year, I mean. It's a good year. Amen. Having a good time. Amen. We already got it. I want to encourage all the young people. You ready? We have 38 young people going to HYC. And when God, yeah. When God spoke to us that he was going to double our youth group, I think we had about 22. That means about 4 to 6 young people. The prophecy will come forth as being true. That's pretty cool right there. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. And if we can get the burden, amen, to raise money. I know some of you don't need to raise money, but there is other young people that do. Amen. We want some of these kids that their parents don't come to this church, like William. We want him to be able to go to HYC. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. You young people can go now. Amen. Hallelujah. A lot of exciting things coming up. Please check the church calendar. Amen. Either in the Encourager or the ALCA's Christmas program is tomorrow night. Amen. If you want good singing and good time, come here. All these kids do a good job. ALCA's Christmas program. Is that tomorrow night? Right. Yeah. Yeah. All right. You're dismissed. I love you. Be good. Be careful. Be holy. Be righteous. Be real. Be attitudes.